والسلام على سيد المرسلين سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. For all brothers who were not here, we just start a lecture about the Quran, inshallah, for those who want to be with us, inshallah, for this evening. الصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. My brothers, we had the activities of the Islamic conference, which we had for 3 days here. My name is Baslan Qurashi. I'm coming from Geneva, where I've been living for almost 40 years, and I'm originally from Jordan. So I would have the pleasure to talk to you. We have a big mosque in Geneva, and we have the experience. Also, we have lessons in Tajweed, that means the rules of the recitation of Quran. So I'm happy to talk about the Quran to you, inshallah, since we have this evening. I'll be leaving after, inshallah, to talk about the Quran and the history of the Quran. The book which we all have before us, wherever we go to the mosque, we find this book. It's worthwhile to talk about the history of this book. I'm not going to speak at first, you see, about the virtues of the Quran. You should be have perhaps listening to that with all preachers of the Imam during the days of Friday and other days. The Quran which we have in our hands now, and we call it Al-Mus'haf Al-Uthmani, it's a development of the original Quran. So when the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam was receiving the revelation by means of Gabriel alayhi salam, he was always having these revelations written by his companions. First, many people said it was not written. No, it was written. And even the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam prohibited his companions to read any hadith or anything not to be mixed with the Quran. So whenever the Quran was revealed, his, what we call them, the clerks of the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam, were putting that down into many materials. There were 7 materials. There was the stones, there were the leather, there was also the bones, there were the things which you put on the animal to ride on it. There are many materials on which it was written, and before anything else, it was written also on the leaves of palm. You see, so that what you use normally in that area. So the whole Quran was already written down when the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam died. Everybody understands English, or should we shift to Arabic or
English?
I don't know. I mean, everybody speaks English. Yeah. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam has written, or he has allowed his companions to write all that down. As you know, when Gabriel came down and he asked the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam, as we all know, that he was an analphabet. So he told them, ma ana biqari, I don't read. So it's the companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam who has written that down on these materials. Now the question was that the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam himself never ordered the compilation of the Quran. That was something which came later. The Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam used to revise the Quran with Gabriel once a year. And that was always during the month of Ramadan. And in the last year before he dies, he revised that with Gabriel twice. So that was for the verification of the order of the Quran. So Gabriel was telling him to put these verses, for instance, in that place, these verses go in the surah, and the whole Quran was compiled up to the rules which were already, I mean, decided and ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Gabriel was the means. He was sent to arrange all that with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. When the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam died, there was an idea to Umar ibn al-Khattab, who was the second caliph after Abu Bakr al-Siddiq has taken the caliphate after the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. They sent people, they were asked to have people to send to other peoples or tribes and to teach them the Quran, because it was only by heart that it was kept. Nothing, it was only the copy which was written immediately on these materials. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when he left that, you see, after the revision with Gabriel, he didn't say anything about the order. But at the time of Abu Bakr Siddiq, they sent about 50 people from Hafiz al-Quran, and all of these people were killed, especially after a battle which is called Al-Yamama. And many of these people who have the Quran by heart, they were killed, you see, in the battle. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, you might be astonished, why Umar ibn al-Khattab? Umar ibn al-Khattab, even in the era of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he had always good ideas. And these ideas were sometimes verified by the sky, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like al-Adhan, he has dreamt of that. And it was al-Adhan which was decided by the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Many things, for instance, when there was a divergence between Abu Bakr al-Siddiq and Umar ibn al-Khattab about the prisoners of Badr. Also again, the Quran came to confirm the ideas of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. So he came to Abu Bakr and he said, look, we have to compile the Quran in one book. And what was the answer of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq? Never. I'll never do something which the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam hadn't done. Why? Because he wanted to avoid anything which we call bid'ah, any invention which hasn't been decided by the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. But we don't forget that the tradition belongs to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and to the four caliphs after him. So if the caliphs do something, also it's part of this prophetic tradition, you see. So Abu Bakr Siddiq was hesitating and he didn't like to say anything because he refused categorically the idea of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. How come that the Prophet in his life didn't order that at all? And so the Prophet, the brothers, if you can come, Abu Bakr Siddiq has to obey what Umar ibn al-Khattab alayhi salatu wasalam has ordered. So why to obey? Because he convinced him. Now we have in the Battle of Yamama about 50 people killed who have the Quran by heart. What happens if there is another battle and then other Hafiz? That means all these Hafiz will be exhausted, will not exist anymore in the society, and then there is no Quran. Exactly that what happened in the Bible, for instance. The Bible was written after Jesus Christ has been taken to the sky, and about 8 years later, all sorts of falsification had happened to the Bible because it was not written in the right place, you see. It's because of that you have many versions, and now you have perhaps at the time of the Romans, when they have the conference of Nicea, they call it, that was about 400 versions of the Bible. Even they were hesitating to choose which. They chose almost three of them, and then a fourth one to call them the canonical Bibles. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when he died, you see, there was nothing, as we said, in one book. Umar ibn al-Khattab has that idea, and then since Abu Bakr al-Siddiq started to reflect on it, in the end, he has accepted to compile the Quran. So they called four people who were among the clerks of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. They were the head of that group, a working group, it's called, he's called Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu. These people, also these people who were the clerks who were writing down whatever came from the sky, all revelations were written also down during the era of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So they accepted, and there was like committees, small committees or subcommittees. Every verse has to be verified by two companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And second thing, there was two criteria. First, the number of clerks which have to be present. So if two or three confirm the ayah, that means there will be no doubt. And second thing, and which is also which was very important, that they have to rely on the language in which the Quran was revealed. The Quran was revealed in the language of Quraysh. Could you call it a dialect? It's not a dialect. It was the literary language which prevailed in the Arab Peninsula at that time. So there were even the word like at-tabut. There were doubt to write at-tabut, the last letter. Is it with ta marbuta or ta maftuha? And then after that they decided that it's ta maftuha as we see it, ta. Why? Because it's the language of Quraysh and it's the way the Quraysh have written their books or their poetry. It was in with this team. So when they compiled the Quran, that was one copy only. It was very fine. For instance, many Sahaba told that there was no separation between At-Tawbah and the precedent in Al-Anfal. It's because of that, they said, no, we don't say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, because I've been following the sayings of many Sahaba. It was like a continuation of the same surah. Anyway, it was compiled. The Quran was here, but it was one copy. It hasn't been repeated, and many versions were burned so as not to mix them up with others. Even there are suhaf, things which the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam has said, and they were burnt also. Why not to mix them with the Quran? So you can be sure, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, we have revealed the Quran, inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidun, and we'll give the guarantee for keeping it till the last day, وَإِنَّ لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. That means the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he has this assurance, he also worked to keep it. So nobody was allowed to write what the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said so as not to be confounded, you see. The Quran should be pure and should be guarded till the last day. So they put that copy. Abu Bakr Siddiq رضي الله عنه, as you might know, he died after 2 years and 2 months from his caliphate. Then there was Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu for 13 years. And when he died, they give this copy to Hafsa. Hafsa is the daughter of Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anha and the wife of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Hafsa kept that copy. And then after that, as we know with the conquest of Islamic conquest, the Muslims were everywhere in the world. You see, when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, they came, they were like a Bedouin tribe, a small society. They started with one person, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, then his companions. But at the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab, we know that the Islamic world went everywhere, to India, to China, to all these areas, even if they were not already, perhaps there was no Islamic conquest, but they were on the doors of these territories which belonged to great powers at the time. So Umar, the people, when they went out, there was a divergence between the Muslims themselves. Don't forget, now we have the Arabs. The Quran was revealed in Arabic. But the Arabs did not count anymore, account for perhaps one-tenth of the population which became a Muslim population, and they don't understand the language. On top of that, some of the companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam or other Muslims which followed them, they were reading in a manner which was not approved by the other party, and there were divergency. And they came back and they told Uthman ibn Affan, who was the third Khalifa, that now we have divergences at the Jews and Christians and their Bibles. So what could we do? Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu felt the necessity to write the Quran and not to keep only this compiled copy. So he asked the Hafsa to give him that copy. He took it and he again charged committees of four clerks of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, presided again by Zayd ibn Thabit, the same person who was writing at the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and who was charged with the first mission with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq again to write it, and they wrote the Quran, which we have now in our hands. It's letter by letter and point by point. I would like to say this Quran, if you call it, for instance, the most prevailing Quran, it's called Mashaf al-Haramain, which is the standard copy. That means all that was written at the time of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. Still, there is something which is perhaps lacking here. What about the Quran if we see it? I went myself to Mecca in one Umrah, and I saw this Quran, which was written at the era of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, and I was astonished. I'm not Hafiz myself. I'm teaching the rules of recitation of Quran, you see. And I was astonished that I couldn't understand a single passage of the Quran. People who were Hafiz with me, sometimes through one word, they could also predict the rest of the verse. Why? Because without punctuation, nothing could be read at all. For instance, if you say يَقُولُونَ, it could be تَقُولُونَ, يَعْمَلْ, it could be تَعْمَلْ, it could be نَعْمَلْ. It's only the punctuation which differentiates these versions from each other. So at the time of Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, we see it happened in chains, you see. From the Prophet to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Umar radiallahu anhu, Uthman, and at the time of Ali radiallahu anhu, they started to set the rules for punctuation. Punctuation, even in English, if you read some, perhaps you receive on the web also some things, if we just change the punctuation, the meaning changes. I received something about men and women once on the web. You just change the points and there is another meaning. So that's the divine word. And they started to put the rules. Why? Because Abu Bakr, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he has an assistant, in reality, a man who specialized in phonetics. He's called Abu al-Aswad al-Du'li. This man, he was hearing people saying, إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَرِيءٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ وَرَسُولِهِ. Imagine that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala denies the associators and his prophet. That means it's like renegades, I mean the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. If you say wa rasule, that means that. If you say wa rasulu, that means Allah also denies the deeds of the associators. So when he heard that changed the whole meaning. He went to Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and they started to write the punctuation. Not only the punctuation, what you call small vowels in Arabic. That means you don't write it as a whole vowel, like alif, waw, ya, small. If I say la, fatha. So he was saying la, and then Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was proposing to put that over the letter. Li, kasra, hu, dhamma. All these things were set in that copy of Al-Mashaf Al-Uthmani. This Mashaf Uthmani was written, some ulama says, 8 versions, and some say only 6 versions. One was sent to Mecca, one to Medina. I say it was sent to Mecca because, of course, we know that Mecca and Medina, I mean the first two cities, to Bahrain, to Bilad al-Sham, which means Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, and Palestine, and also a copy sent to Kufa, to Basra. At least there were 6 versions, and these are the book which we have in our hand. Do you have any question about the development of the Quran until now? Because I'll be talking about other aspects of Quran. Have you anything about the historical development of the Quran? Sister, do you have any question?
Sarah was given to talk to a homologist in a dialect other than his.
In what?
In a dialect, other than one he was familiar with.
No, but there was no dialect. You mean dialect?
Yeah.
There was no dialect at that time. Mm-hmm. The literary language, it's like English nowadays or French. The spoken language is the literary language. There was no difference between the dialect and the literary language. Everybody spoke literary Arabic, which is literary Arabic in which the Quran was written. But it's not a dialect. What you mean, it's a version of that literary language, which is from Quraysh, that means his tribe in Mecca. Exactly as if you compare the English of London to the English of, let us say, Liverpool or the other city or New York. That means it's not really a dialect. It's a version of the literary language, if I can call it that way, you see.
Have you heard that too? Have you also heard that there was some Asia or some sort of divided in a version different than
Muslim? No. Never, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said in the book that He will guard it to the last day. And here, perhaps if there is no other question, that will lead us to a question which I will raise myself. What is the miracle of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam? Anybody knows what's the miracle of the Prophet?
Al-Quran.
But that's the book. For instance, Moses has miracles, his hand and his stick, but he has another miracle, which is not miracle, that means the book, the mission, was his book, which is Torah. Jesus Christ also, he has many miracles, but then he has the Bible as book. So that was his mission. So what's the difference between Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the other prophets? That it's right what you say, it's the Quran, that his mission and his miracle both were in one thing. It is the Quran, you see. So the Quran, he's the only prophet who has the book and the miracle in one thing, which is the Quran. Why? Because the Quran was revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with two objectives. It was also what? A challenge to the Arabs. Don't forget, in every era that there was a messenger of Allah, we should differentiate, messenger is not the prophet. Messenger, he has a book, a prophet hasn't a book, but he propagates the book of the messenger which preceded him, you see. So every messenger of Allah has always a miracle in the field which was prevalent at his time in his own country. So let us make it more clear. In Egypt, it was Pharaoh, you see, and the magics were there in Egypt, you see. Everybody was talking about it. It was a la mode, as you say in French. And because of that, the miracle of Moses was in that field. It's a miracle to have a stick and it moves and eats all the other sticks of the others. To have his hand, which is almost, he was half black, perhaps Yusuf, and when he took his hand like that, it was quite white, and there are other miracles. Jesus Christ, it was medicine at his time. It's because of that his miracles were in that field. And then we come to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. His miracle was the Quran, and his book was the Quran. Why? Because what prevailed in the Arab Peninsula at that time, it was the literature and precisely poetry. It's the rhythmic sounds which you pronounce, exactly as when you say in English, you have, for instance, also this rhythm which exists. I refer always to the English because I suppose you all speak English. There are something which they call rhythmic meters, iambic, trochaic, all that. That means there are certain rhythms which appear after one another, and that's what distinguishes poetry from prose. So that's the point. Literature and precisely poetry was prevailing everywhere. Just a verse could also elevate the position of a tribe or just reduce its position. Even there was one verse somebody says you are from the tribe of Kulayb, you don't reach the level of Numair and another tribe, I don't remember the name. This verse, it was said in the literary books that for 30 years the people of that tribe couldn't look at the eyes of the others because they were reduced, you see, to zero in the eyes of the others. So the importance of poetry and of rhetoric, when you have, if you have, if you speak about things, you have to have a rhetoric. If you want to convince the other, you can be eloquent more than anybody else. So it's because of that the Quran came to challenge the Arabs. Now try to make just 10 verses as the Quran. Not only you, even human beings and jinn, these invisible creatures, try to meet together and make some verses similar to that. And Allah says in the same verses, وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا, you won't be also capable of doing that. And you see, everybody know that the history passed, nobody could. Even there is somebody called Musaylim al-Kadhab, who also proclaimed prophecy, and he was a liar. He tried to make something, but when you read it, it's ridiculous. Even to Arabs from our era, where we don't find also, we don't have that rhetoric and this the prose and poetry which prevailed before, we don't understand it, absorb it as good as the people before. So that was the first, that is the challenge to the Arabs precisely. And that's the first thing. Second thing, it's the challenge to the whole humanity, were it at that time or nowadays. And you might hear every day about al-i'jaz al-Qur'ani, the miraculous style, but also the miraculous phenomena. You see, in the Quran, nobody will kill you because you see the globe is round, you see, as happened to Galilee, because it's written in the Quran. Not even that it's round, he said it's like the egg, you see. And that's the reality. If you look at the earth from a real, I don't know, photo from the astronauts which they have taken, it's exactly like an egg. It's a bit like the form of Africa. It's not round, as you see it, or as you learn that in schools, you see. So what happened that this i'jaz, we find it nowadays is much more important than before. Why? Because scientists have discovered things which never existed at that time. At that time, then nobody would have thought that after 160 kilometers there is no gravity and you can walk and then you fall down and you play in the air. All that couldn't, nobody could imagine. Not only at that time, even let us say 120 years ago, if you speak about the aeroplane, it was the brothers Wright who found that in 1903. Before that, albeit cars, albeit all these inventions. And now, with the IT technology, I mean, things happen. For a good believer, his belief will immediately augment. You see, it will go higher. For somebody who denies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his creation, it will go down because he will trust more this IT technology and he will think that will compensate for everything and the human being is capable of doing anything by himself and he does not have to go to references. When you say Allah, in our European society, some people, they laugh. Why? Because they have this secular mentality. You have to see the nature. If, say, your body does that and then and you mention the name of Allah. No, it's not Allah. It's the nature. The body is done to adapt itself by itself. So all that, you see nowadays, it exists everywhere. I don't know, perhaps in the States or here in Canada, it's less. I don't have the experience. I was in 1985 in the States, and it's my first time in Canada, but also you have many secular people who don't believe anything of that. So the second part, let us come to the subject. There was the i'jaz, what we call it in Arabic, the miracle but the scientific miracle. And this miracle is the biggest one. Why? Because if you are wise, and the Quran invites you always to reflect on this, to reflect and to think so as to find the truth. If you, I give you just an example. For instance, you've heard perhaps about the phenomenon Big Bang. Big Bang, that's a big theory which started to appear with the internet in the 60s, in the beginning. And they say that the sky and the earth were one piece, and then there was a big explosion, what they call Big Bang, and now we have the earth apart. They are not together. That's mentioned in the Quran, in the standard copy, page 324, Surah Al-Anbiya. وَكَانَتِ الْأَرْضُ وَالسَّمَاءُ رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ. The sky and the earth were one piece, then we separated from each them from each other, and we made from water everything which is vivacious, which has life, you see. So you can see this thing exists. Now we have in Geneva a big center. Perhaps you have heard of CERN, the Central European research for nuclear things. It's the biggest in the world. There are 23 kilometers downstairs, a lab, and they produced 1 or 2 years ago, if I remember, the same thing to produce Big Bang, you see. And they made the same effect, but underground. They had one day their doors open to people, and there was somebody who was giving a lecture, an Englishman, and he was talking about this Big Bang. I asked him, I raised my hand, and I said, is there anybody who does not believe in Big Bang? He said, impossible. Till now, since the 60s, till now, there were 12,000 physicists, and now there is 1,000, nobody could deny that phenomenon. I said, do you know that exists in the Quran? Yes, I have heard of that, but it might be a coincidence. So it's a sort of pride, which I don't appreciate very much. You find the truth, and that guy, since he has heard of it, I think what does impede him from going and reading what was mentioned in the Quran? It's just because he does not like to. So you see, this I'jaz Qur'ani, this is very important, especially if you have people and you think they might convert to Islam. Why? Because if you fix parameters, you see, and then these parameters are fixed. Nobody could say that the sun is black, because we said it's shiny. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not says that it's shiny. He says also it has a heat. It's because of that he called it siraj. Al-qamah, you have the light of the moon. All these things, nobody could deny their form or their function nowadays, because everybody knows that these things are really something which is given. You cannot really contest their nature. So when the Quran comes and confirms such things, you see, and you see a book which was revealed to a Bedouin in the desert, 1400 years ago, 14 centuries ago. How could he know all these details? Even the greatest scientist wouldn't have also predicted what will happen in the future, and you see that in the Quran. It's because of that there is an author, his name is Maurice Fokai. I would advise you, or even if you have people who think and reflect about Islam, to buy that book for them. That will cost you 20 or 30 francs, dollars perhaps. You see, it's called The Bible, The Quran, and The Science. This guy, he grew up in Lyon, in France, and he grew up in a family which hates Muslims, Arabs, those people who compound everything. For them, Islam is an Arab is Islam. And then he wanted to choose one of the religions. And that's the method which he applied. What did he do? He said, I'll take the natural phenomena and I will compare the sacred text to them. He started by the Old Testament, by the New Testament, and then the Quran. In the Old Testament and New Testament, he found many contradictions from the first page. You see, from the first page, there was contradiction what was said. That means it couldn't be a divine word where you have a mistake. It could be a divine word in the second or third page of the Old Testament. You have Lut, alayhi salam, who was a prophet, and you find that his daughter is taking him to bed, and then she convinces her sister to take him to bed. Why? And to have sexual relations with her father? To keep the human race. Do you think we need to do that to keep the human race? To go on to have this, sin with your daughter, which is more than a sin with somebody else, you see? All that exists in the Old Testament. Don't go further, because the contradictions will be much more. That does not mean that everything has been falsified. No, there are passages like concerning Moses. There are passages which are identical with the passages we find in the Quran. That means they were not touched. Parts of them were not touched, not all of them. So this Maurice Foucault, he took the natural phenomena, among which the Bing Bang, and he found out that the Quran has spoken of these phenomena. Then he closed his eyes and he said, how come 14 centuries ago, somebody in the desert, how could we think on all that? And then after that, to find in the Quran, if the Quran was not, derived from Allah, لَوَجَدْتُمْ فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا, you would have found a lot of contradictions. So that means it's really the divine word, and we cannot have any doubt about it. Even that should be the case for somebody who's a Muslim. Perhaps we inherited Islam, we are from Islamic parents, but we have to think things over. I think myself, if I were coming also from American European parents, I would have thought of all of that. I didn't adopt Islam because my father is a Muslim. I was reading and I was hearing a lot about Islam also before becoming a good Muslim. I hope that I'll be a good Muslim anyway. We spoke about the miracle of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So his miracle and his mission book are in one, which is the Quran. Now, what's the wisdom of having the mission book and the miracle in one book? Anybody could have an answer to that? And that's very important also. Why? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Moses a book and then a miracle which is not in the same field? Jesus Christ the same. Everybody, even from the days of Abraham, it's completely separated except in the case of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Mm-hmm. Do you have an answer, brother?
Yeah. For later generations, could he send to humanity for people like 1,000 years after the Ummah?
So
he's the last prophet.
He's the last prophet. As you said, last prophet. How did we know all things about Abraham, about Jesus Christ, and about Moses? It's through the Quran and the sayings of the prophet. If no prophet will come later, that means we cannot get any information about Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam himself. So things, and that will be the last religion till the last day. Even when Jesus Christ comes down, he will be propagating what? Islam. So that's the point. He's the last prophet. And when he's the last prophet, that means that should be the last word, which should be kept in the hands of everybody till the last day. Also, that's a challenge to humanity. Now you have a book. Even if you are American or Canadian or European, you have a book. You can read about Islam. You know, even after the 11th, what do you call it here in the States? The 9th, 11th, or something like that. I think there is an expression. there are many people who started to learn about Islam, and there were many people converted to Islam through a bad act that led them to reflect on Islam and to adopt Islam also. So that was the point. He's the last prophet, and that will be the last book, and it has to be a book which is kept till the last day. There is nothing which comes later. It's because of that, anything you hear in the future, we don't believe in anybody except Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam as the last messenger. And we don't accept any personality which is sacrificed and the given a big dimension which has nothing, not even from his family. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is the reference, and we believe in Islam, not in Muhammad, it's not his religion, but he was the means, I mean, to convey this message to us. So that's the second point. The last point, perhaps I don't like to be, when is Isha? But I'll be finishing a few minutes, inshallah. Isha is about six?
Seven.
Yeah, but that's Isha before, yes.
The Azan is at 6:17.
Yeah, okay. The last point which I'm talking about, you know that the Quran, as I told you, I'm not going to speak about the virtues of the Quran. There are also in the Quran itself, the sayings of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. I'm sure perhaps wherever you go to Friday prayer, the preachings are full of this hadith of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. But I will mention one saying of the Prophet, which is very important. خيركم, the best among you. من تعلم القرآن وعلمه, the best among you is this one who learns the Quran and he teaches it. That means once you learn the Quran, also you have the mission to convey it further to others. What you have, whether it's little or big, you see, you just convey it to others. It's because of that in Geneva since 25 years. Every morning after the prayer, Lillahi alhamd, we have halqa, and we talk about many aspects of the Quran, but it's dedicated precisely to the recitation of Quran. That's very important. When Gabriel, alayhi salam, revealed the Quran to the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, there was a very specific manner in which it should be read. You cannot read it with the mistakes you do. As an Arab, you cannot read it the way you read any newspaper. When you read out a newspaper, you can do that, but you cannot do that with the Quran. It has a certain music, a certain intonation, which has to be respected in reading the Quran. And you can find, the more you read the Quran, the more you reach a certain of, I would say, a pernickety perfectionism in reading it. That means there are rules and we have to respect these rules. As far as you have the possibility to do so, you are supposed to read the Quran in this manner, which is called rules of tajweed, how to write it, how to pronounce it. You have the exits of the letters. Every exit has to be pronounced, not as when you speak your dialect or when you read any book. It has its certain form, and these forms, you cannot learn them from a book. It has to be taken from mouth to ear. So you sit with people, it's because of that, people who teach tajweed, normally they go in chains up to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Nowadays, we have another manner in doing that. If you can do it well, to imitate the recitator of the Quran as good as you can. For instance, you have Al-Hudayfi, you have Sudaisi, you have Shuraim. All these people read with the rules of tajweed. But mind you, you might not be aware of many rules because you are not specialized in that field. It's better always to go to a teacher and to read that with him. For instance, for an Arab, if you say beh, or B, he wouldn't find the difference. If he does not speak English or French, for him, bit and bet is the same. For him, hell and hill is the same. You see, what I learned, and you have to pay attention with these vowels in Quran, they might change the meaning completely. And to pay attention before anything else to the declension of the words and the verbs. But if I say, خَلَقَ اللَّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, Allah has created the skies and the earth. If I say, خَلَقَ اللَّهَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, just Allah, I make Allah, the skies and the earth have created Allah. To which extent you can see just who or ha, that would make the meaning. It's because of that when we took the Bul Aswad Du'li, that was the point. إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَرِيءٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Allah denies the associators and denies his prophet. When I say wa rasuli, if I say wa rasuli, denies the associators as well as his prophet. That means the prophet denies and he's not denied by Allah. So you have to pay attention to these small vowels, and when you go to the rules of tajweed, and mind you, many ulama think it's fard ayn. It's something which is incumbent on every Muslim to learn these rules exactly, so as to distinguish the Quran from any other text. Do you have any questions with regards to this point? Yeah.
How did the what you've talked about, the compilation of the Quran,
yeah,
inform the compilation of the Hadith, which comes afterwards, specifically, yeah, the Hadith which is explaining ayahs of the Quran?
Yeah, the whole Hadith, it started to be written in the second century, Hijri century, and it was codified only in the fourth century, you see. So before that, there was practically no Hadith. It was only Hadith which circulated between people from mouth to ear, you see, nothing else. So there was no Hadith at the time of the revelation to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Even after, till the book was written, the book of Allah was written, you see, and the Hadith started after. And that was the objective, not to have it mixed with the Quran. Because imagine, you know all, the whole tradition of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, how many Hadiths were falsified? We don't talk now about the Bible. The tradition of the Prophet was falsified once Imam Ahmad taught his son about 10,000 hadith, and he said, forget them. I said, why should I forget them? He said, they are all are falsified. So to which extent? He wanted him to avoid these hadith. So he keeps them in mind. If you tell him that one of these hadith, he knows that it's not the right one. So the authentic hadith were done by Bukhari and Muslim and was in the fourth century. That would correspond to the 10th century Gregorian calendar, you see. So that's the point. There was in reality no hadith at the time, only the hadith which were circulated among people till a later stage. Tafadhal. An-nasakh. What do we mean by an-nasakh? It means the abrogation. That means whether the Quran was abrogated by Sunnah or whether it's abrogated by Quran itself. In reality, abrogation exists, but it depends. I mean, you have to go back to the books to see whether it was a right abrogation. There were things which were abrogated, for instance, and that everybody knows it. Whereas in some cases, they said even the prophetic tradition abrogates ayah, and here there are divergences among the imam. So you have to take them case by case, the abrogation. But I will tell you, just I know it's not your question, but anyway, that leads me to something. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Ali Imran, هن آيات محكمات. That the Quran is divided into two parts. There are the parts which are quite sure. He called them ayat muhkamat, tightened verses. That means nobody, like when you tighten something and nothing could penetrate. So these are the ayat to which, or with regards to which, there is no any under interpretation. It's only one interpretation. If Allah says, for instance, perform your prayer, that will be perform your prayer. It couldn't be interpreted in any other way. And here you pay attention. وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْخٍ. But those who have deviation in their hearts, that means they have the intention in advance to do something, فَيَتَّبِعُونَ مَا تَشَابَهَ مِنْ. They go to the verses which are allegoric. If I don't know whether I'm clear with that, allegoric, that means like symbolic. Allegoric verses, that means if Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَدُ اللَّهِ فَوْقَ أَيْدِهِمْ, the hand of Allah is over their hand. Of course Allah does not mean his hand, but that means he's over them. When they give, he's richer than them. I mean, there are many interpretations. Now people who has the intention already to deviate from Islam and to try to interpret it on their way, they take these verses and try to play with them. We know nowadays there are whole groups. How Allah istawa ala al-harsh? How did he sit on the throne? He has a space or he hasn't a space. We say he's everywhere, but how can he sit in one place? That means he does not exist in the other spaces. We, the Muslims, we call that al-ilm al-kalam, the science of dialectic or anything similar to that in English, and we have to avoid all these things. We are taking a religion. Look, we believe in Allah. Have you ever seen Allah? Nobody has seen it. Malaikati, have you ever seen the angels? Nobody saw the angels. Huh? Have you seen the Iman Billah wa Malaikati wa Kutubihi? His books, we know all of the Quran. Him, but not us, I mean. Did you see Muhammad alayhi salatu? We didn't see him, you see. So the book, the last day, did you see the last day? The day of judgment? Not yet. All the, we believe in a religion, 99% of which is unknown and invisible, you see. In French, there is a saying which we say in Islam, like, for instance, when you buy, let us say, the leather of a bear which hasn't been killed yet, you see. So if you, all that, 99% of a religion you don't know, why should we know about the manner in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sat on the chair or on the throne? There is a difference. Chair is something else than the throne. So all these things are taken by people who have the intention in advance to deviate from the right path of Islam. It's because of that we don't have really to pay attention to these people. They are responsible. The liability is there. They are responsible in front of their God. And we know we have a religion. We believe in everything we've never seen and we've never talked to. And it's because of that. It's not strange to believe in all these things. And the pillars of faith in Islam are things which we don't, you see, testify.
Tafadda. It's just a question on the pronunciation. I was wondering if, like...
Most of people in Geneva, of course, they are Francophone and they say George, they don't George. I'm from Jordan, we say in English Jordan, but they say Je. So that does not exist in the... And the Ga, I think all Egyptians know it. They cannot read the Quran with the Ga. So it's
I've
Cha.
Heard some imams use the Ga.
No, that's completely wrong. And even some say when you say that, you cannot also stand behind him because that's not the pronunciation of Quran. And it could change the meaning in many words. If you have the time, I'll show you when you say Ga. Anyway, the Ga does not exist in Arabic. There is no letter in Arabic, Ga, or Ba, or Cha. These letters are Persian letters. In Persian, you have four letters which. Cha, yes. In our dialect in Jordan and the countryside, we say cha. Yeah, and the whole Arab world have it. But it does not exist in literary Arabic. When we speak about literary Arabic, when you read the news on the TV or the newspapers, you see, there you cannot use them. In dialect, yes, but they came through invasion. Don't forget that up from Saudi Arabia, from Jordan on, that was all a Roman. They spoke Aramaic at that time and many other Semitic languages. So that was not Arabic. Of course, the Arabic stems from the literary language. But we have many letters which do not, also which do not, are not derived from the Arabic language. It's one of them. Ga exists in Urdu also, where you have the ka and the other line on it. But in Arabic, there is no ga. And everybody in the Arab world say ga for the qa. Because the qa is a bit difficult, they say ga. But that does not exist. We have to distinguish literary Arabic in which the Quran is written from the spoken dialects of the Arab world. Now, nobody speaks literary Arabic in the Arab world. Nobody. Not even the Saudians, you see. Nobody speaks. It's because of that. They are dialects which come from that language, but they don't have anything to do with the language in reality. Yeah. How about that?
You mentioned earlier that some words in Arabic have multiple meanings in English. So what
they have what?
Multiple meanings in English.
Yeah.
So what I'm wondering is how reliable are these English translations of the Quran?
Yeah, you leave me. Anyway, I always thought that Yusuf Ali is the best translation. Whereas, I mean, I just read a book about many mistakes which have, I mean, he made a big effort, but we cannot blame him for that. Perhaps it's a sort of verification. There are also sometimes they change the meaning. There is Muhammad Asad, there is Bakshol. There are many translations in English, but I would advise you the meaning, it couldn't be Quran anyway. It's not the Quran, it's the meaning of the Quran. But I find, again, Abdullah, Ali Yusuf or Abdullah Yusuf is called? Yusuf Ali. He's the best translation. I read many. In Bakhtol, there are many mistakes. In Muhammad Asad, he has many mistakes also. But in this one, it's the closest. But it couldn't bring the meaning exactly, you see, of the Quran. Because this all the specific of the own language. As when you translate Shakespeare into French or into Arabic, all books of Shakespeare exist in all languages of the world. But I doubt whether one of them gives him really the dignity he was in his own mother tongue. So it's a question of translation, as any translation, you see. So it didn't give this exact meaning as in the original language. Yes? It's a sign of satisfaction, inshallah. I'm quite happy. Anyway, if you go to Geneva, we are in the big mosque. Every morning after the lecture, after the prayer, we have lectures about Quran, and also in the evening. I hope if you go to Europe one day, you will find us over there if Allah gives us life, of course. And I wish you the best. Is there a difficult thing concerning, I mean, the Qurans or the interpretations of Qurans which you have here? No? I mean, you have everything concerning, for instance, for Tajweed. Do you get people teaching the recitation of Quran or no in the mosque? I have no idea. It's my first time in Canada.
I think they have programs, but
yeah. Anyway, it's better to have it, as I said, on cassette and you compare. And now you have another also style. It's just which is called al-qalam. You put, I mean, it's a sort of steel. You just put it on the line and it reads for you. I saw that in Saudi Arabia. And it gives you the translation in English or in which whichever language you want, you see. And that's very good. So you just put that to that. I saw it in Saudi Arabia when I went to Umrah, and I think now it's quite common in the mosques in Europe also. And then you can read everything with that qalam, and you don't have any doubt that these people who recite the Quran, and I would also recommend you Al-Hudhayfi, Ali Al-Hudhayfi, for the exits of the letters, to pronounce them perfectly, you see, it's this man who's the best, and we take him always as an example. If you try to hear, of course, I mean, especially these young people, they can keep it well. For all geezers like me, it will be difficult. But I started at the age of 12, you see, to read the Quran. I mean, I was reading it before, but to learn these rules, it takes 2 years to 3 years to master them, depends on the rhythm. If you do that once a week or do it every day. But anyway, they are very hard. And mind you, they are harder to the Arabs more than non-Arabs. Why? Because the Arabs, they got accustomed to a certain tradition which has nothing to do with the right reading. So they have to rectify also their reading from the beginning. Whereas, for instance, in Geneva, we noticed that people who are converted to Islam, just they start with, even they don't speak Arabic, with the reading of the Quran the right way, and they reached really a better level than those who has Arabic parents or parents who were reading like some Pakistani, and from the beginning they were reading that. So it depends really on your effort. And we shouldn't forget that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I didn't create the human being and the jinn only to adore me. And it's because of that if we give more effort to the Quran and to keep some surahs from it and to pronounce it the right way, I think that's even has the priority on everything else. If you have a child and you go to somebody who's not hafiz but he has rules of tajweed, it's more important to make this guy teach him the Quran than somebody else who has the whole Quran but who he doesn't pronounce it well. So that's very important, and many brothers know it. And compare with the cassettes. Really, that's the best way. I repeat that because like Al-Hudayfi, like Al-Husari, Abdul Basr, Abdul Samad, who's the oldest among them, you see, we were hearing him when we were children. They read in the best way, and they pronounce everything as it should be pronounced by the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. Okay. Barakallahu bikum jami'an. I thank you very much, and I hope we'll have the occasion again. I'm leaving today, inshallah, but I might have the opportunity also in the future, and we might see each other another time. Barakallahu bikum jami'an wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Barakallahu bikum jami'an. Allah barak. Allah barak.